On the programme, Leonard Cohen, Pictures of a Life. Hello and welcome to Arts Tonight.
If you want a lover, I'll do anything you ask me to. And if you want another kind of love, I'll wear this old mask for you. If you want a partner, take my hand. Or if you want to strike me down in anger, here I stand.
Leonard Cohen there with a song from his 1988 album, I'm Your Man. That song ringing out in Cohen's memorable concerts at Kilmainham in Dublin last year and in his other performances in Dublin and at Lissadell in Sligo in the past few years. Cohen has a huge and loyal following in Ireland, and many of you will be interested in a fine new biography of Leonard Cohen entitled I'm Your Man and written by London-born US-based music journalist Sylvie Simmons with the quiet, if not official, support of the man himself. It's a fascinating portrait of a fascinating life with many striking photographs and real insights into the man, his music, his loves, beliefs and art.
But the moon's too bright, the chain's too tight, the beast just won't go to sleep. I'd say, please, I'm your man.
I guess that's some kind of basic view I hold about the thing, that it doesn't really matter what the singer is speaking of. It doesn't really matter what the song is. There's something I listen for in a singer's voice. And that's some kind of truth. It may even be the truth of deception. It may even be the truth of the scam, the truth of the hustle in the singer's own presentation. But something is coming across that is true.
Well, my friends are gone and my hair is gray. I ache in the places where I used to play. And I'm crazy for love, but I'm not coming home. I'm just paying my rent every day in the Tower of Song. I said to Hank Williams, how lonely does it get? Hank Williams hasn't answered yet, but I hear him coughing all night long. Oh, 100 floors above me in the Tower of Song.
Something is coming across that is true, and if that isn't there, the song dies, and the singer deserves to die too, and will in time die. So the thing that I listen for is that note of something being manifested that is beyond the singer's control.
I was born like this. I had no choice. I was born with the gift of a golden voice. And 27 angels from the great beyond. Tied me to this table right here in the Tower of Song.
Power of Song there by Leonard Cohen, and before that you heard Cohen himself from John McKenna's RTE Radio 1 documentary series How the Heart Approaches What It Yearns, recorded in the late 80s, and more from that later in the programme. Sylvie Simmons, Leonard Cohen's biographer, has been telling me about her book and the man born with the gift of a golden voice, as he described himself in that song with customary irony. What was her own interest in Cohen and his music, and how did she come to write this biography?
Leonard had the good manners to release his first album the day I hit puberty. And at that age, I couldn't actually afford an album, and I bought a compilation album that came out in all across Europe but not in the US, where Leonard was largely ignored for many years. It was called The Rock Machine Turns You On, and there was a track on there called Sisters of Mercy, and little girl that I was, I heard it, and for some reason or other, having no idea what he was singing about in particular, it just threw me up against the wall. I loved it so much. So the kind of love affair with him, certainly musically, no other version, happened very early on in my life. And then over my years as a music journalist, I came to appreciate him greatly and interview him. And finally, when he did this, the first of his kind of, as they call it, comeback tour, though we knew he never went away really, in 2008, I just was so amazed by this huge wave of love that greeted him across the world in places where it had even been ignored, really, that I thought, really, I need to get behind this, find out what's going on, and see if I can understand in some way the great mystery of Leonard Cohen.
And were you familiar with the basic facts of his life before you began to write the book?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'd read every book that was in existence on him, I think. And I did a very long interview with him in 2001 for Mojo magazine, that I write for over in England. And in that thing, the interview lasted over 3 days, and we covered the whole of his life in it. But I realised when I left, like everybody who has an interview with Leonard, male or female, they come out of the room with a little rose in their cheeks and sort of smoking an imaginary cigarette and thinking they've got the best interview on God's earth and that he's opened up to them like no one else. And then when you read it back, it's wonderful stuff, but he's not really told you anything. You know, he's managed to be as elusive as ever.
What kind of person is he to meet and interview? I mean, he seems on stage, he exudes charm and warmth and grace. And is he like that in person?
Oh, absolutely. He'll throw in the odd cuss word in person, but in a very elegant, poetic way. It's quite funny. The only other thing that I found about him that surprised me as a human being is that he's a kind of real Jewish mom. He just wants to feed you when you're there. I think he was worried that I might die on his watch of starvation. So I think he fed me about 5 times in one day when we had one day's interview.
We'll talk about his own real Jewish mom in a while, but I suppose many of his fans are intrigued by Leonard Cohen's life and the intersection of his life and songs and writing. Let's go back to the roots, as you do, to his childhood in Montreal. He talks about his messianic childhood, but it seems to have been a relatively conventional Jewish middle class upbringing to the age of 9 and his father's death.
That's right. It was actually a very high status Jewish family, though. He was very much raised with a sense of his own importance. There were rabbis going back forever. He had a great uncle who was the chief rabbi of Montreal. His family had founded the biggest synagogue in the city. You know, he was important. The massive synagogue that took up a whole block just down the road from where he lived had these huge portraits on the wall in oils of his great-granddad with his long white beard and his grandfather. And his family's owned big companies. I mean, there were richer families than his in Montreal, but his was one of the ones that everybody talked about as being very, very important. But it was also, it's strange, I remember his friend Mort Rosengartner told me, as his childhood friend, he said, we kind of, the Jews got lumped in with the Protestants on the grounds that we weren't Catholic and didn't speak French. So they were kind of minority that was, in a sense, sort of was glued together with this kind of this Protestant population in this neighborhood. So he was kind of getting used to all seeing crosses on the hill as well as synagogues. It was very kind of mixed and outsidery at the same time.
And of course, those themes, Christian, Jewish, are so strong in his work. The work's imbued with Christian and Jewish iconography, and clearly that's there from very early on through his family line.
Absolutely. A big mix. Also, he had an Irish nanny who used to take him to her church. That was very interesting. So he really just incorporated it all. But, you know, obviously he was brought up mostly in the synagogue. That was his main religion at the time. But ever since, he's been really pretty much as soon as he hit adolescence, he became a spiritual seeker. He was studying quite seriously all different paths.
Now I've heard there was a secret chord that David played, and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
You see, I have a very sympathetic take of Catholicism and Christianity because I wasn't brought up as a Christian or a Catholic. So, but I saw it operating from the outside, so to speak. And I didn't have to suffer any of the things that my friends say they suffered from it, although they seem to be pretty healthy and pretty tough and pretty soulful people. Even the ones that complain about the tyranny of their Catholic education. I always said to myself, well, I'm sure they're complaining about something that is real, but they seem to have turned out pretty good in spite of it. So maybe there is a certain genius to that education that operates even though, you know, there's an occasional thorn in the stick.
You say the name in vain. I don't even know the name. But if I did, well, really, what's it to you? There's a blaze of light in every word. It doesn't matter which you heard. The holy or the broken. Hallelujah.
I think that everybody leads a spiritual life. I don't know if it's even worthwhile to designate it as that way. Everybody is in touch with their own resources, with their own deep pools of divine activity. Otherwise, they wouldn't be here on this plane. They'd evaporate. I mean, everybody is living a so-called religious life. Everybody lives a so-called spiritual life. Everybody is in touch with these powers. Otherwise, they wouldn't be around.
There's a beautiful line in the book where I suppose the great love of his life, Marianne, and we'll talk about her later, somebody had predicted to her that she would meet a man with a golden voice, who could speak. It's a beautiful image, and it's so true. It seems so true of Cohen.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. She is wonderful to talk to, and as I say in the book, if there was a kind of People's Choice Award, you know, a kind of X Factor of muses, she would definitely win the prize. Very, very gracious woman, very gentle.
Tell me a little bit about her, about the Marianne that he made so famous with that wonderful song, So Long, Marianne.
Mm. It's so strange that he made her famous with a song that says goodbye. But one of the curious things, actually, is that when I was doing research, I went to the Columbia Studios where Leonard had recorded the earlier albums and found the old artist cards. And the song, when he started recording it, and I guess when he first wrote it, was called Come On, Marianne. And that somehow, within the process of recording it, he changed it to So Long, Marianne.
Come over to the window, my little darling. I'd like to try to read your palm. I used to think I was some kind of gypsy boy before I let you take me home.
so long, Marianne. It's time we began to lie and cry and cry and laugh about it all.
But she was a very sweet lady who lived on Hydra, a Greek island where Leonard had moved in 1960. He'd been living in London briefly. He'd managed to get a Canadian grant. They were always giving people grants. And he'd managed to convince them he wanted to go to all the great capitals of the world and write a novel about it. And he started in London and was living in Hampstead. And after suffering one English winter, he decided to clear off and go to Greece and ended up on this island called Hydra, where there was an expat community of writers and artists. And Marianne was included in that. She actually wasn't an artist herself. She was a model, but her then husband was an author from Norway. And she was living there with their baby son. The marriage broke up, and then she met Leonard, and they were inseparable after that.
You say in the book also that that Greece and Greek culture have been of huge importance in Leonard Cohen's life.
They really suited him. I hadn't realised that so much. It was a very close friend of his had told me that. He said that Leonard still carries the Greek worry beads in his pocket. And it's true, he does. And he likes to have a coffee and talk about things slowly and everything. And he likes the routine. When he was living in Greece, which he went back to periodically for many, many, many years, he still has the house, though his children use it, not him. He would just get up in the morning and go for a swim and very early and then come back and work a couple of hours and then have a siesta and write a little more in the afternoon until it got too hot. He liked that kind of very slow, even working regime, but with a lot of relaxation, a sort of healthy mind in a healthy body kind of thing that was going on.
And he has always been an incredibly hard worker. From early on, I suppose we see it particularly now in this new lease of life since 2008, and the incredible dedication and stamina. And you, again, something you say, and I was very struck by it in the book, is that a quality of his that is sometimes underestimated is his ability to survive.
Mm-hmm. His resilience is really something, you know, because Leonard Cohen in so many ways was blessed. I mean, a really good family, a loving family, huge talent, of course, you know, adoration from women. But in other ways, he was cursed, and one of the biggest curses was this depression that he suffered with from pretty much, you know, the second that he hit his 20s. It was a serious depression. His mother had been hospitalized with depression, so we can, you know, assume that there was some disposition towards that. He actually told me, he said that he would wake up thinking, how do I get through this day? What do I do to get through this day? And that everything, he said, the work, the wine, the women, the song, whatever, were all part of the way of trying to deal with the kind of this darkness in his mind, a way of trying to get on top of it and beat it.
I'll cut the darkness. It was drinking from your cup. I'll cut the darkness. Drinking from your cup. I said, is this contagious? She said, just drink it up. I've got no future. I know my days are few. The present's not that pleasant. Just a lot of things to do. I thought the past would last me. But the darkness got that too.
And so he was cursed with this depression, and he was also cursed with a restlessness. So whatever he had, he always had to make it either better or get the hell away from it. So, you know, he had a pretty hard time with certain aspects of his life. And I think that hard work was one of the things of, it was partly a distraction for this terrible depression. You know, he had to keep going and keep going with whatever kind of disciplined regime he could do. But it was also a way of trying to get to the depths of himself and try and get something beautiful out of this darkness that he found down there.
There's a very moving description later of some concerts he gave in the UK and in America in psychiatric hospitals, and an incredible engagement with the people who were suffering as he had clearly suffered too, and him reaching out and having a real impact in those performances.
Yes, I found those stories incredibly moving, actually, that those were very little known about him, that he'd actually been given a series of concerts. And he said that he had a kind of a special connection with people who were mentally ill. He said he didn't really know why. It's just that people, he thought, understood him and his music better. He said even in his teens, when he used to wander the streets of Montreal at night, his mother being very indulgent and not disallowing such things, even though he was, say, actually only about 13, 14 when he was doing this. He said he used to just go and sit with these people and talk to them and somehow just feel comfortable around them.
He was writing from quite early on, and of course he was a poet before he became a singer and songwriter, and poetry was very central to his life and has been central to his life, you know, from childhood. Yeats and Lorca, two of the poets he has revered down the years.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yes, poetry really is, it's very interesting with Leonard that he saw no difference or could, you know, explain no difference between word and music. As far as he was concerned, poems and songs were exactly the same thing and always were, even before he'd become a signed, you know, artist, musician. But when he was 15 years old, he stopped outside a bookstore and was looking through some things on a shelf and saw a book of Lorca, selected poems of Lorca. And he said that when he opened it up and read just a poem at random, he said that he'd heard the music of the synagogue while he was reading. He said that hair stood up on his arms. He was completely bowled over by this. And that same year was the year that he was 15 years old at the time, and that same year he bought his first guitar. And then he was drawn to the kind of the music of flamenco that he got to through Lorca. It was through Lorca's poems that he kind of studied Lorca and found out that Lorca was a kind of musicologist, a collector of old Spanish folk music. And a lot of the poems that Lorca had written were given the titles of songs or ballads. And so I think he drew an awful lot from that. You know, it really seemed to connect with something in him that seemed to be looking for that kind of fusion of music and word.
There's also a very striking encounter you describe with a Spanish guitarist who entered his life very briefly and left it suddenly and tragically, but I suppose gave Cohen this incredible gift, this legacy and influence.
Yes, it's one chop, as he calls it, on the guitar. Yes, he was the house that Leonard's mother and sister and he lived in was over a park, a really beautiful park. And he was sitting looking out of his back window at the park, and he saw this handsome young man standing against a tree near the tennis courts. And he was playing an acoustic guitar, and there were girls gathered around, and Leonard was rather obsessed with young ladies. And so he went down to see what was going on, and he too was entranced by the music. And when it was all done, he went to speak to the young man to ask if he would teach him how to play that music on the guitar, the Spanish music. It turned out that the guitar player was a Spaniard, couldn't speak English, and so they kind of communicated in broken French to each other. The guitarist came over to Leonard's house and taught him a few things, you know, where to put his fingers, basically, to make the kind of flamenco chords, and taught him a few little bits and pieces. But on the fourth lesson, didn't turn up. And Leonard called the boarding house where this young man was staying and asked what had happened. And the landlady told him that the boy had killed himself. Never knew why. He was just gone. And so Leonard would stand in front of a mirror and just practice this one sort of tremolo kind of flamenco thing over and over again in front of the mirror, trying to recreate having his teacher, young teacher, standing opposite him.
Who in your merry, merry month of May who by very slow decay, and who shall I say is calling.
It's interesting, actually. Leonard took a mirror into the studio with him to make his first album because he felt more comfortable playing that way.
And of course, mirrors feature quite strongly in the lyrics, in both the poems and the songs. There's a photograph I love. One of the many wonderful photographs in the book is this really early photograph of him with the Buckskin Boys in Canada. And it's Leonard as a potential country and western star.
Yeah, that is absolutely adorable, isn't it? Yeah, a little fringe jacket and a cowboy hat and that kind of very cheeky look on his face that you don't really see in Leonard Cohen too much. He's gone more for the gravity generally. But yes, a square dance band of all things. Yeah. So this was his only band, really, when he was at college. I know he only looks like a baby in the picture. But yeah, he wasn't even the lead person in it either. Somebody else called out the do-si-do and everything. But Leonard loved country music. And when he decided that he was going to get into music as some kind of way of making a living, it was meant to be as a country songwriter. He knew he couldn't sing. Actually interviewed his old rabbi, ancient man in Montreal. This is the rabbi who taught Leonard's bar mitzvah class. And if you bear in mind that Leonard's 78, it gives you an idea of the age of this old rabbi. And one of the questions I'd asked him is whether Leonard had sung in the synagogue. And he looked at me with horror and threw both hands in the air and said, "Leonard, sing?" So Leonard agreed that he didn't really have a voice that was made for commercial success. So... And the only real music that he knew was George Jones and Hank Williams, and thought that he could maybe try his hand at writing country songs. So I guess that all kind of stems back to the Buckskin Boys.
And of course he loved the voice and the songs of Hank Williams in particular.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And when I saw him on, not this tour, but the last tour, his backstage pass had a photo of Hank Williams on it.
The poetry, writing from early on and publishing his first book at 21, in a sense something of a prodigy, and it seems apparent from those early years that he was going to do something remarkable in his life. But at that time one might have expected that it would be as a poet in particular that he would make his mark.
Well, he became a sort of golden boy of poetry in Canada very, very, very quickly, pretty much from that first book on. Leonard said that a lot of this had to do with the fact of being from Montreal and being in Canada, that he probably wouldn't have been acclaimed as a poet had he lived in, say, London or New York, because where he was, he said there were great poets who became kind of mentors. You know, they took him under their wing, but more than that, they criticized him. They really would get together and almost have battles. It was really serious stuff. There wasn't anything polite about it. People would come out bloodied, you know. And he said that because of that support, he was able to kind of get further and get more encouragement, you know, from the public as well with his poetry. But he said at the same time that, you know, he was selling books in sort of like the 500s or something. You know, he wasn't able to make a living from that. And he totally refused to kind of go the family way and, you know, follow into running one of the family companies or kind of making money through commerce or anything. So he wanted to make money only from the work he did. And that was why, as I say, he kind of moved from poetry into trying his hand in the music business.
Some of the poem texts were to become songs, As a Mist Leaves No Scar, for example, and more famously, Suzanne. Tell me how he came to write the poem Suzanne, which became one of his best known and best loved songs.
Yeah, I was curious. I actually spoke to the woman, Suzanne, herself, to get her side of the story on it. She's a very interesting lady who now lives in Santa Monica, California, but was a Montreal dancer and was a beautiful woman, married to one of his friends, a sculptor. And he went down to her place by the river and she fed him tea, you know, and oranges, like she said. Actually, a little orange peel in the tea, as she described it to me. And her perfect body was only touched with his mind because she was married to his friend. And so she said that they had a spiritual connection. And he wrote this beautiful poem that became his first song, and it was covered by Judy Collins. As I say, Leonard didn't particularly want to be a singer-songwriter. He wanted to sell songs.
Suzanne takes you down to a place by the river. You can hear the boats go by. You can spend the night forever. And you know that she's half crazy. That's why you want to be there. And she feeds you tea and oranges that come on.
This thing, and poor Suzanne heard about it and was quite horrified that this had become her life had been made public in that way, which is rather a shame. But Leonard often had women that he knew as his muses, and this was one of the important ones, and such a fantastic, mysterious song. I mean, it starts as reportage, and then it suddenly we get Jesus walking on the water, and it has this huge space to it, you know, like a song being sung in a cathedral. It's a wonderful song.
Travel blind, and you know she will trust you, for you've touched her perfect body with your mind. And Jesus was a sailor when he walked upon the water, and he spent a long time watching from his lonely wooden tower. And when he knew for certain only drowning men could see him, he said, all men will be sailors then until the sea shall free them. But he himself was broken long before the sky would open. Forsaken, almost human, he sank beneath your wisdom like a stone.
Sylvie, you mentioned Leonard having had many women who were muses, but in the case of Joni Mitchell, they were lovers briefly. He became her muse. She turned the tables in a sense. And until I read your book, I didn't know that her great song, Case of You, was written for and about Leonard Cohen.
Yeah, in my blood like holy wine. That's our Leonard. Yes, they were sort of almost having little kind of song battles, you know. Both of them wrote a song called Winter Lady as well. Very interesting. Yeah, I think she was the first one that kind of gave him a run for his money as far as songwriting talent, though both of them were just starting out when they met, you know, as musicians. Leonard beat her as far as having a career as a poet beforehand, and she had actually asked him for a book list of things to read, and he was a huge influence on her back then. But I think over time, you know, she started changing her mind a little and was a little more dismissive of him later on.
Just before our love got lost, you said, I am as constant as a northern star. And I said, constantly in the darkness, where's that at? If you want me, I'll be in the bar. The back of a cartoon coaster in the blue TV screen light. I drew a map of Canada, oh Canada, with your face sketched on it twice.
And so the face sketched twice on the map of Canada in the song is actually Leonard Cohen's face.
It would have had those two deep lines either side of his mouth. Yep.
It adds to the image. It would become invidious to list the many women that he loved who came in out of his life. But I suppose again, many people will think of Janis Joplin and the Chelsea Hotel, and I suppose their famous encounter there.
I remember you well in the Chelsea Hotel. You were talking so brave and so sweet. giving me head on the unmade bed, while the limousines wait in the street. Those were the reasons, that was New York. We were running for the money and the flesh, and that was called love. For the workers in song, probably still is for those of them left. Yeah, but you got away, didn't you, babe? You just turn your back on the crowd. You got away, I never once heard you say, I need you, I don't need you. I need you, I don't need you. And all of them jiving around.
I think later he almost came to regret having named her as the woman in that song.
Oh, he completely regretted it. I mean, he was horrified that he had done it. He'd sort of let that slip out. He thought it was very ungentlemanly and a great indiscretion. And he said that even if Janice wouldn't have minded, his mother would have minded. And I guess she must have given him a good telling off about that too.
And most of the women he loved have remained close friends of his.
Well, I wouldn't say most, because otherwise it's a huge amount of numbers. But, you know, the interesting thing is that, right, certainly the main lovers, the long-term lovers, they all seem to have a very soft spot for him.
You know, it really is a pity the way you treat me now. I know you can't forgive me, but forgive me anyhow. The ending got so ugly, I even heard you say you never ever loved me, but could you love me anyway? I dreamed about you, baby. You were wearing half your dress. I know you have to hate me, but could you hate me less? I've used up all my chances and you'll never take me back, but there ain't no harm in asking, could you cut me one more slack? I'm naked and I'm filthy, and there's sweat upon my brow, and both of us are guilty anyhow. Have mercy on me, baby, after all I did confess. Even though you have to hate me, could you hate me less?
And Leonard loved women. He didn't just love them horizontally. He loved them vertically and every other angle in between. He worked with women from the outset. His first manager was a woman. His most recent one, the one who, before now, I mean the one that's now behind bars, a woman. All the people who made his songs famous in the beginning, like Judy Collins, woman. So he's always relied on women for support, and that may well stem back from having been raised in a house of women, of having his mother and his big sister, Esther, no other siblings, being there for him when his father died, when Leonard was nine.
1969, a momentous year, as you say, for Cohen. He meets the woman, Suzanne, another Suzanne, who would make him a father, and the man who will make him a monk. Tell me a little about those two people and those trajectories in his life.
Whew, what a year that was for the man, really. I think, Suzanne, this is the second Suzanne Elrod, the mother of Leonard's only two children. She was significantly younger than he was and living in a very fancy hotel in New York with an older lover and even older than Leonard. And Leonard was living in the Chelsea Hotel, and they met at a Scientology class. This was one of Leonard's spiritual pursuits that actually he did take fairly seriously, but didn't stay with long. He did go clear. I found a certificate in his archives that he is an operating thetan. But he sort of bowed out of it very, very quickly afterwards. So it was just one of the paths that he was taking.
Explain that term, going clear, because it was something I wasn't familiar with. And it's a phrase that crops up in famous Blue Raincoat. Did you ever go clear?
Mm-hmm, one of my favourite songs. And yes, going, did you ever go clear? To go clear is to have done a certain amount of courses of auditing, as it's called in Scientology, which is that kind of, they have this device, it's an e-meter that has a couple of things that look like baked bean cans attached that you hold, and apparently it kind of clears you out of the scars of your childhood. And after you've done, you've sort of passed a certain amount of these courses, you can go clear and become a you know, different levels of an operating theta, I think it is. I'm not an expert in Scientology, though I tried to be for the book. And so he did do that for a while. And he told me, I'd asked him about Scientology. I was confused because, you know, most of us don't have the warmest regard for it. And he said that it had, quote, very good data. And what he meant was that back in the late 60s, it was pretty much operating almost like a kind of an equivalent of a self-help book, you know, it threw some Freud in it, you know, it was all about kind of childhood scars and trying to overcome them. And so I guess that Leonard probably put aside some of the stranger aspects of it to do with people from outer space and stuff, and decided to use it for its kind of self-help mechanisms, you know, because he was suffering from depression and suffering like a lot of people were suffering in the late 60s from wondering why the old orthodoxies weren't working and why it was such a harsh and difficult time.
The spiritual journey then into Buddhism, which begins when he meets the Zen master Roshi, and he mm-hmm. goes to Mount Baldy, and his gradually he becomes more and more immersed, I suppose, in Buddhism, to the point where he becomes a monk. Somehow it from everything you've written up to that point, there's a strange logic about that, and it's as if he was travelling to that point to meet the man who would take him there.
Yeah, it's a very, very, very interesting thing. He met Roshi through one of his close friends from the Greek island of Hydra, Steve Samfield. Steve has been the subject of a couple of Leonard's poems and is a poet himself. And he happened to go to his friend's wedding, a Buddhist wedding, and met Roshi, who was overseeing the wedding there, and loved this old guy who talked to us about shouldn't drink too much, and sort of celebrated that by opening several bottles of sake and drinking them. And so I think he took to Buddhism straight away. But he took a long time to get to the monastery. He probably spent about 30 years of going there for the odd week, you know. I went there for 2 days and I dug an escape tunnel after stealing a spoon from the refectory. It was hell on earth, I tell you. But he stayed there for 5 years and was officially ordained a monk. But it's really curious because before that, you were talking about the path, this trajectory leading that way. Just before he'd gone up and committed to the monastery, he was engaged to be married to the actress Rebecca De Mornay, and he'd had his biggest selling album in America. So these different strands of his life, the religion, the music and the woman, you know, there they were. And it was almost like a, you know, if that would be a film, it would be like, choose which one you're going to go with, you know. You can see it. Which path are you going to take? And he decided to leave the woman and the music and go and live with the old man on Mount Baldy.
He goes to the mountain. Something, again, I did not know was the extent of his drug taking. I mean, he seems to have taken just about every drug going, at one point becoming known as Captain Mandrax. And it seems astonishing that he came through all that, you know, when you consider all the casualties in the music business.
It is, I think, as again, that survival instinct and the resilience. He said that he sort of finally gave up taking acid because his stomach wouldn't deal with it anymore. I think it was more his instinct for survival that wouldn't deal with it anymore. But a couple of times I was a little shocked. I felt like a mum. I was going like, you, really? You know, especially when he was talking about amphetamines, huge amphetamine intake. And just the thought of Leonard Cohen on speed, I just couldn't get my brain around that. And he said, darling, you should hear me when I'm not on speed. And I should say he calls all women darling, not just his biographer.
Somehow I think, though, that Leonard Cohen on speed might still be very slow. I suppose, again, you know, this the other shift in his life, leaving the monastery and facing financial ruin, 2008, and you referenced it earlier, his manager had had basically cleared out his bank account.
That's right. This is just, you know, it could only happen to Leonard Cohen, couldn't it? You know, when you get to these parts of the story, you just think, oh, Lord, this can't be true. But it was totally true. When he went to the monastery, he gave power of attorney for his finances and even more scarily for his medical conditions, i.e. if a plug had to be pulled, this person would say so, to his then manager, who had been briefly a lover, but they'd been platonic friends for many, many years. And she'd been his manager for a long time. He'd known her. She'd been his manager since 1988, when his previous manager died. She had worked with that manager. And Leonard also employed her parents. So it was a very close relationship. But something happened. Nobody knows what. He was at the monastery, and somehow or other, she managed to wipe out all of his bank accounts. Not on her own. There were other people involved, and it's such a sensitive area that we'd have to say alleged every 2 seconds. But, you know, I managed to get through all the legal papers without tearing out too much of my hair and fingernails and get the story in the book. But basically, he was left with nothing. And at the age of 70, he was forced to mortgage his tiny little house. I mean, this man is not living like a, you know, a kind of king. To mortgage his house in order to pay off lawyers and to pay off the IRS, the American Inland Revenue. Because if you take money out of retirement accounts and things, you have to pay tax on it, even if it wasn't you that did it. So it was a horrible, horrible mess. And a huge upset to him. I mean, he was very modest in how he talked about it. He said, it's put a dent in my mood. But, I mean, even a kind of, you know, an enlightened Zen monk is going to get a little bit unhappy with the idea of realizing he's penniless and pretty much forced to go back to work.
And he went back to work with gusto. He has toured extensively since then, back to Ireland several times in those years. And I think each time, you know, the concert's just getting better and better. And his stamina is astonishing.
Amazing. I went to the first of the US concerts in Austin, Texas, and I went backstage and I said hi, and he looked 10 years younger than he did the year before. I mean, something's happening up there. I think in the beginning when he went back on the road, he was very reluctant. In fact, I know he was very reluctant because Roscoe Beck, his musical director and bass player, told me that Leonard kept saying to him, I'm kind of 70% sure I'm going to go. And then another day it would go down to 55%. And he said it didn't go up to 100% until they were about halfway through that first tour. So he was reluctant. He always had some ambivalence about touring. He still has stage fright, believe it or not. He's worried about going on tour. But he's also frightened for his art. He, you know, the idea of taking it out on stage and playing the same song every night, he had this fear of somehow ruining its purity by, you know, pimping it, if you like, parading it in front of paying customers. But now, after this last tour, this triumphant tour from 2008 to 2010, he just fell in love with it. And I saw him back in his house a couple of months later. And, you know, he looked like, somebody had taken his toy away from him. He really wanted to get back on the road, really, really deeply. And he made an album and went straight back on tour. And I think it's going to keep going until they yank him off, you know, and I don't think that's going to happen because he keeps selling out the shows.
He also seems to be very much at home in his own being, you know, in his skin and soul on stage.
Oh, yeah, he does. It's really interesting. When he was young, he said he wanted to go to military academy. Again, something that shocked me about Leonard Cohen. But he said he really, really wanted to go. His dad had been one of the first Jewish officers to serve for Canada in the First World War. And he said he wanted to wanted to get into the military. He kept trying to sign up to different wars. I don't know if you remember in the book, he, you know, went over to Cuba during the Bay of Pigs invasion, I guess, to offer his help. And he tried to sign up for the Israeli army, but they turned him down and just sent him out with a guitar to sing to the troops. So he had this kind of militaristic side to him, and he always used to boast about the Rinzai Zen monks, and you know that was the Buddhism strain that he followed. He said that they're the marines of the spiritual world. He likes that kind of discipline of being out there wearing his uniform, in this case a suit for the show, and just knowing what he's doing and what he's meant to do. Somehow he found more freedom within those restrictions than just being left with his own mind.
It's rather wonderful in the book to look at the photo of Cohen's daughter Lorca as a small baby and to think that she now has a baby of her own with Rufus Wainwright. So the music goes on. There's something really terrific about that.
Oh, absolutely. His face is such a doting granddad. When I was over at the house after the first tour, and he was looking for something, I think it was the notes for something on his computer, and every now and then he would just stop at the picture of one of his grandchildren. He has two. He has one by his son, Adam, as well, a boy. And his face would just break out into this huge beam like a little kid, you know, when he saw his grandkids. So totally doting grandfather.
You mentioned Famous Blue Raincoat as one of your favourites. Do you have other favourites of his songs or albums?
Oh, well, it's a bit like kind of, you know, when you're little and they say, which is your favourite Beatles song? It would change every day with me. The only thing I can say is that my favourite albums are those first three, mostly because I grew up on them, you know, and I just love their darkness and their beauty and their poetry. So I can sit there and play just about on my little ukulele. I'll play you any song you like off of the first three albums.
Sylvie Simmons, thank you so much for talking to us.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
I'm Your Man. The Life of Leonard Cohen by Sylvie Simmons is published by Jonathan Cape. Lots of music on tonight's programme. Details on our website, rte.ie/radio1/artstonight. We'll finish with one of my own favourite Leonard Cohen songs, Not an Easy Choice. Sarah Binchy produced tonight's programme. From all of us, good night.
I went down to the place where I knew she lay waiting, under the marble and the snow. I said, Mother, I'm frightened, the thunder and the lightning, I'll never come through this alone. She said, I'll be with you, my shawl wrapped around you, my hand on your head when you go. And the night came on, it was very calm. I wanted the night to go on and on, but she said, go back to the world. We were fighting in Egypt when they signed this agreement that nobody else had to die. There was this terrible sound. My father went down with a terrible wound in his side. He said, try to go on, take my books, take my gun. Remember, my son, how they lie. And the night comes on, it's very calm. I'd like to pretend that my father was wrong, but you don't want to lie, not to the young. We were locked in this kitchen, I took to religion, and I wondered how long she would stay. I needed so much to have nothing to touch. I've always been greedy that way. But my son and my daughter climbed out of the water, crying, Papa, you promised to play. And they lead me away to the great surprise. It's Papa, don't peek, Papa, cover your eyes. And they hide in the world. Now I look for her always, I'm lost in this calling, I'm tied to the threads of some prayer, saying when will she summon me, when will she call to me, what must I do to prepare? When she bends to my longing like a willow, like a fountain, she stands in the luminous air. And the night comes on, it's very calm. I lie in her arms, she says when I'm gone, I'll be yours.
yours for a song. Now the crickets are singing, the vesper bell's ringing, the cat's curled asleep in his chair. I'll go down to Bill's bar, I can make it that far, and I'll see if my friends are still there. Yes, and here's to the few who forgive what you do, and the fewer who don't even care. And the night comes on, it's very calm. I want to cross over, I want to go home, but she said, go back to the world.
Night comes.